Good afternoon, everybody. This is Dr. S. Ramaswamy, Assistant Professor of Political Science, Indira Priyadarshini Government Degree College, Nampally, Hyderabad. Today, I am going to discuss about one of the important topics of Indian government and politics, that is Indian Parliament. Indian Parliament earlier was the Constituent Assembly. Since 1946 to 1949, the founding fathers of Indian Constitution sat in this building only and wrote the Indian Constitution. So after the completion of Indian Constitution, the Indian government has changed this Constituent Assembly into Indian Parliament. So now it is acting as the Union Legislature. So the Constitution making fathers have adopted the British West Ministry model of parliamentary system to India. Coming to know the background history of early parliaments, since ancient times, when societies were tribal, there were councils and headmans whose decisions were assessed by the village elders. This is called, everybody knows, tribalism. Some scholars suggested that in ancient Mesopotamia, which was supposed to be the first civilizations in the world, there was a primitive democratic government where the kings were assessed by the council. Means he was assisted by a council of ministers. The same has been said about the ancient India, where some form of deliberative assemblies existed. There were several sources which have shown that in early India, democratic assemblies was also there, like Buddha literature. So, and therefore, there was some form of democracy in India. However, these claims are not accepted by most of the scholars who see these forms of government as oligarchies. Coming to know another important reference of having parliaments, ancient Athens. Ancient Athens was the cradle of democracy, everybody knows. The Athenian assembly was the most important illustration. In fact, it was most important ancient institution, I want to say, and every free male could take part in the discussions, whereas slaves, women could not, however, participated in this democratic process. Athenian democracy was not representative but rather direct. And that's why it is called classical democracy, and therefore this kind of democracy was different from that of parliamentary system. Coming to know another stage of development of parliamentary system was, we can see this kind of things in Roman republics, where the legislative assemblies exist, who had the final say regarding the election of the magistrates, the enactment of new statutes, carrying out of capital punishments, the decision of war and peace, and the creation for the dissolution of alliances. So in this way, Roman Senate controlled money, administration, and the details of foreign policy. We can find other reference also in some Muslim scholars, Muslim countries, where the scholars argue that Islamic Shura means a method of taking decisions in Islamic societies is called Shura, is analogous to the parliament. However, others highlight that what they consider fundamental difference between the Shura system and the parliamentary system is totally different. However, the modern system of parliament definitely exists from England only. And England parliament, that is the reason why, has been regarded as the mother parliaments of the world. So in earlier days, the foundation for parliamentary system had laid in England, where England has long tradition of a body of men who would assist and advise the king on the important matters. So this way, early parliaments came into existence. However, before going to know about the nature scope of Indian parliament, it is important to know the very meaning of the term parliament. Parliament is an originally a French word which means a place where the people assemble and laugh, means laughing house. Coming to know the nature of Indian parliament, as everybody knows that the constitution fathers have opted parliamentary system of government to India instead of presidential form of government. Why? Because so as to give a responsible government. So in modern politics, everybody knows a parliament is a legislative body of government. So it is a legislative. Generally, a government is having three organs: legislature, executive, and judiciary. So parliament, nearly I want to say 70% of the world's legislatures' names have been regarded as parliament. Others are having different names, like I want to say Diet, then Duma, or Congress of America, etc. But most of the countries of the world are having the name parliament. Why? That is very important to know. Why? Because as I have already told you that British Parliament is the mother parliament of the world. So wherever Britishers have ruled, as everybody knows that Britishers have ruled Asia, Africa, and Latin American countries. So all the earlier colonies of the British have followed the or put the name of their legislatures as parliament. This is the reason. However, generally, a modern parliament has three functions: representing the electorate. Means it is the place where the electorate have been represented properly. Second important work is making the laws, and third is to oversee the government via hearing and inquiries. However, the term parliament is similar to that of idea of senator, cat, Congress in America, and is commonly used in countries that are current or former monarchies, a form of government with a monarch as the head. Some contexts restrict the use of word parliament to parliamentary systems only, although it is also used to describe the legislature in presidential forms also. That is another thing to be discussed. Historically, parliaments included various kinds of deliberative, consultative, and judicial assemblies. India has a parliamentary system of government where a union legislature is called parliament, which is the supreme legislative body in the country. Coming to know Indian constitution, the position of parliament in Indian constitution, that stands in article 79, where this article of Indian constitution provides that there shall be a parliament for the union, which shall consist of the president and the two houses, means the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. So article 79 says that Indian parliament consists of the president, Lok Sabha, and the Rajya Sabha. And these Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha are earlier known as Council of States and House of the People. This is what the introductory part of Indian Parliament. Coming to know the structure of Indian Parliament. So the fathers of Indian Constitution have chosen bicameral legislature for Indian Parliament. You know one thing, in India, as India is a federal state, where at the central level it is having the legislature, that is called parliament. At the state level also the legislatures are called the state legislatures. Means so what I'm trying to say that in India some states are having bicameral and others are having unicameral, but founding fathers of Indian constitution have chosen bicameral legislature to Indian system of government. So in this way, Indian Parliament is bicameral. So bicameral legislature is the legislature where it is having two houses, lower house and upper house. So which is consist of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. However, the member of house means lower house, that is called House of People, where the members are directly elected by the people through voting process in general elections. The member of Rajya Sabha, that is the Council of States, are elected by the members of state legislative assemblies. The Rajya Sabha is the permanent house in the sense that it cannot be dissolved, unlike Lok Sabha, which has a fixed term of 5 years and can be dissolved earlier. The Lok Sabha is a lower house and which is having a maximum strength of 552 members, out of which 530 represents the states, 20 represent the union territories, and the 2 members from the Anglo-Indian community. Coming to know Rajya Sabha, Rajya Sabha is the upper house, and the present strength of Rajya Sabha is 245 members, of whom 233 are representatives of the states and the union territories, and 12 are the nominated by the president. So in this way, president is having the power to nominate the 2 members from Anglo-Indian community to the Lok Sabha and 12 members from different fields to the Rajya Sabha. And the remaining have been elected by the people directly to the Lok Sabha and indirectly to the Rajya Sabha respectively. However, the Rajya Sabha is a continuing body, means permanent house, where 1/3 of its members retire after every 2 years. Thus, each member is elected for a term of 6 years. Though it is expected that the members should be elected on the basis of interest of the states, yet in actual practice, all the elections held on the party lines. This is the ground reality of Indian parliamentary system of government. Parliamentary system where the legislature controls the executive. So, let us know the qualifications which are required to become the member of parliament. So, in order to be chosen as the member of parliament, a person must be the citizen of India. This is applicable to all, either for Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha. And he should not have the age of 30 years in case of Rajya Sabha and not less than 25 years in case of Lok Sabha. However, additional qualifications may be prescribed by parliament from time to time by law. Like the candidates should not hold any office of profit either in central government, state government or private office. So these are the qualifications of the parliament members. Coming to know one of the important area of parliament, that is the powers and functions. So Indian parliament performs several functions like legislative functions. Primarily the function of parliament is legislation, law making. Executive functions, though we are having separate executive for implementing the laws made by the parliament, but at certain occasions Indian parliament also performs certain executive functions. Financial functions, parliament also performs financial functions. It also performs certain constituent powers, means constituent amending powers. Even though we are having a judiciary, that to unified single integrated judiciary, but parliament also performs certain judicial functions, electoral functions and other functions. Let us discuss one by one. Legislative powers. So all the legislative powers of the federal government are vested in the parliament. It means federal government means central government or union government. Whatever the laws that have been enacted by the parliament must be applicable to the whole country. The laws framed by the Indian parliament are enforced in the whole country. This is the process where I want to say the parliament follows a special process of making the law. However, as far as the primary function of parliament is lawmaking function, Lok Sabha plays important role. It can pass bills concerning to all those subjects which have been included in the union and concurrent list. Means, as we know that in India, as we have been following federal form of government, where the powers between the central and the state have been divided into 3 lists: union list, concurrent list and state list. So what I'm trying to say here is that the parliament can make all the laws which have been enshrined which have been included or discussed in union and concurrent list. No bill become a law unless and until it has been passed by the Lok Sabha. In case of any disagreement that has been made between the two houses, the will of the Lok Sabha will prevail over the Rajya Sabha. Because the Lok Sabha has more members than Rajya Sabha. In fact, it is the representation of the representative house of the people. The parliament, what I want to say, legislates on all matters mentioned in the union list and concurrent list. Like for example, union list includes income tax, custom duties, defense. These are the matters that have been included in the union list. Concurrently, matters like education, sports, okay, welfare programs. Actually, I want to say that the definition of concurrent list. Concurrent list is the list where both the central and the state government are having the power to make the laws. So, as far as Indian Parliament is concerned, whenever the clash that has been taken place between central and state over making a law among the concurrent list, then the law of central will prevail the state law. So in this way, directly all the provisions that has been written in the concurrent list will be under the control of the parliament. In case of the concurrent list where the state legislatures and parliament have joint jurisdictions, means they can make the law, the union law will prevail over the state, unless the state law had received the earlier presidential assent. This is the condition. However, the parliament can any time enact the law adding to, amending or verifying or repeating a law made by the state legislatures. It means that certain times parliament can also make the law in the state legislature, means in state lists. The parliament can also make the laws on items in the state list under certain circumstances only, like emergencies. For example, if emergency is in operation or any state is placed under president's rule, that is Article 356 or Article 352 also, for national emergency, it was the parliament that enacted the laws on all the items of the state list as well. A second important condition where the central government can make the laws, means parliament, over the state list is Article 249. Empowers the parliament, in fact. Means according to this Article 249, the parliament can make the laws on items in the state list if the Rajya Sabha passes the resolution by 2/3 majority of its members present and voting, that it is necessary for the parliament to make the laws on any enumerated in the state list, but the condition is that it should be for the national interest. This is what the constitutional provision that has been assigned to the Indian parliament to make the laws, but from the state list, but for the national interest. Article 253 says that according to this article, the parliament can pass a law on the state list items if it is required for the implementation of international agreements or treaties with foreign powers. Means if any international treaties or foreign means what I'm trying to say, that agreement that has to be implemented, then this article, that is Article 253, empowers the parliament to legislate on any item of state list. Last, according to Article 252, if the legislatures of one, means state legislature, if legislatures of one or more state passes a resolution to the effect that it is desirable to have a parliamentary law on any item listed in the state list, then the parliament can make the laws for those states which have requested to make a law. So in this way, under four conditions, first during emergency, second if the Rajya Sabha passes a law for passes a resolution for the national interest, third for the proper implementation of the international treaties, fourth if the state legislatures more than two or three have requested parliament so as to make a law, then the parliament can also have the right to. So in this way, we can say that as far as lawmaking powers are concerned, it is the parliament is having more powers. Coming to know another important powers and functions of the Indian parliament, that is executive functions. Executive is there in the name of Council of Ministers so as to implement the laws made by the parliament, but here parliament also performs certain executive functions by having its control over the executive. So in parliamentary form of government, the executive is responsible to the legislatures. Hence the parliament exercises control over the executive by several measures, like by vote of confidence. That is the most important means of parliament of having its control on the executive, where the parliament can remove the cabinet, means executive, that is the real executive, out of the power. It can reject a budget proposal or any other bill brought up by the cabinet. A motion of no confidence is passed to remove the government from office. The MPs, means member of parliament, can ask questions to the ministers on their omissions and commissions, means all the members of council of ministers are responsible for their commissions and omissions to the legislatures during question hour or zero hours. So any lapses on the part of the government can be exposed by the parliament members. So adjournment motion, this is one of the important means or way where the parliament has exercised its control over the executive. This adjournment motion allowed only in the Rajya Sabha. And the chief objective of the adjournment motion is to draw the attention of the parliament to any recent issue of urgent public interest. So it is considered as an extraordinary tool in parliament as in the case of normal business is affected. The parliament also appoints a committee on ministerial assurance that see whether the promises made by the ministers to the parliament are fulfilled or not. So in this way, parliament is having control on the executive. Censure motion. A censure motion is moved by the opposition party members in the house to strongly disapprove any policy of the government. It can be moved only in the Lok Sabha. Immediately after the censure motion is passed, the government has to seek the confidence of the house. Unlike in the case of no confidence motion, the council of ministers need not resign in censure motion if censure motion is passed. Cut motion. Cut motion is used to oppose any demand in the financial bill brought up by the government. So in this way, these are the either no confidence motion, adjournment motion, or question hour, or zero hours, or committee on the ministerial assurance for having a watch on the promises made by the ministers, censure motion or cut motions, through which the parliament exercises its control over the executives, means council of ministers. Coming to know financial functions, parliament is ultimate authority when it comes to finances. So it is having what I want to say, a fund that is called consolidated fund, from which it generally used to give the salaries to the higher authorities of central government. So it is the parliament which is having the power either to raise or to decrease the amount of this consolidated fund. So coming to know the executive, according to Indian constitution, the executive cannot spend a single pie without the parliament's approval. In fact, that is union budget prepared by the cabinet is submitted for the approval by the parliament. So it is the parliament which has the power to approve the budget. All the proposals to impose taxes should also be approved by the parliament. There are two standing committees of parliament, that is public account committee and estimate committee, which are totally financial in nature, which these committees are supposed to keep a check on how the executive spends the money granted to it by the legislature. So in this way, parliamentary also play an important role in having a control on the executive. Constitution amending powers, which is very important. The parliament in India, the parliament has the power to amend the constitution. So whereas judiciary is there to protect the constitution, but parliament is there so as to bring the amendment in the constitution. Up to now, Indian constitution have been amended nearly more than 128 times. Here, both the houses of parliament, either Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha, are having the equal power as far as constitution amendment is concerned. But as far as financial bill is concerned, Lok Sabha is having more powers than the Rajya Sabha. Why? Because Rajya Sabha is having only the permission to keep the bill for 14 days, not more than that. If they are going to keep the finance bill more than 14 days also, the Lok Sabha is not going to consider or take the consent of the Rajya Sabha, it passes the bill. So, but as far as constitution matters are concerned, both the houses are having the equal powers. Amendments will have to be passed in both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Okay, Article 368 of Indian Constitution explains about various types of amendment procedures, particularly three important ways or means through which a parliament can bring the amendment in the constitution. Simple majority, absolute majority of both the houses of parliament, or absolute majority of parliament and half of the state legislature's council. Let me explain. Simple majority. If any proposal that has been related to changing of the state's name, changing of the borders of the states, changing of the name of the, what I want to say, the cities, okay, like earlier the names of the cities like Madras, then Calcutta, Mumbai, these have been changed. Not only these, the names of the states also, like Pondicherry to Puducherry, Madras to Chennai, Calcutta to Kolkata, Bombay to Mumbai, Odisha to Oriya. So in this way, all these, and even I want to say the increase of the division of the states, means bifurcation of the states also under the control of the union government only. So so all these litigations have to be done under the simple majority of the parliament. So parliament is the only one, okay, which is exclusive, which has the exclusive power of amending the constitution as far as this matter is concerned. Okay, this is what exclusive power of the parliament, where by following simple majority. Simple majority means the proposal for amending the constitution is taken place, okay, on the day when the members, as everybody knows that for the proper functioning of the parliament, there must be a quorum. Quorum means 1/10 of the total members of the parliament. So conducting a meeting, you require, means parliament should, the members of the parliament should have 10%. If 10% of the people are also, members are also attendant on that day, so 50%, 50 plus 1 should vote for the resolution for bringing the amendment in the constitution. This is called simple majority on the day when the proposal is going to be made. Second, absolute majority of both houses of the parliament. Here also the parliament is having exclusive power to amend the constitution by following absolute majority. Absolute majority means 2/3 majority. Here everybody should attend on the day when the proposal is going to made for amending the constitution. Okay, it is a lengthy process. In fact, I want to say that here everybody should attend. Either in Lok Sabha, 245 should be 545 should attend, or in Rajya Sabha, 245 should attend. The full attendance is must. Okay, and after the all the members should attend, then 2/3 of the total members should give their consent for the amendment of the Indian Constitution. So this is applied for bringing any changes in the what I want to say fundamental rights. Fundamental rights in, you know, it has taken nearly 2 years so as to delete the right to property from the fundamental rights list. So it is a time taking process. Coming to know another important means of amending the constitution is absolute majority of the parliament, means the resolution for bringing amendment should pass separately by the Lok Sabha by 2/3 majority, and separately by Rajya Sabha by 2/3 majority, and the same means after the passage of the bill of amending the constitution should be sent to the state legislatures, where the consent of more than half of the states should be required so as to bring the change in the constitution. This is very toughest task, okay, so as to amend the Indian constitution. It will apply for bringing changes in the qualifications of the Indian president, or sometimes so as to bring changes in the Article 368 of Indian constitution. So in this way you can say that the founding fathers of Indian Constitution wanted to give the feature of features of both flexibility as well as rigid. So Indian Constitution is rigid in some way and flexible in some way, unlike American Constitution which is rigid one, and unlike British Constitution which is more flexible. But as far as India is concerned, where the peculiar of Indian Constitution is lies in its rigidity as well as flexibility. Coming to know another important function of Indian Parliament is electoral functions, means it elects. In fact, I want to say the members of Parliament actively participated, okay, in electing Vice President of India and President of India also. The difference between Vice President and President of India is between in President and Vice Presidential election is that as far as Vice President is concerned, the solely it was Parliament's member who are going to elect the Vice President. But whereas President means the elected members of Lok Sabha Parliament and the elected members of State Legislature, somebody says, also participate. So in this way, Parliament takes part in the elections of President and Vice President. The Electoral College that elects the President comprises of, among the others also, the elected members of both houses. The President can be removed by resolution passed by the Rajya Sabha, agreed to the Lok Sabha through impeachment process. Coming to know the judicial functions of Parliament, in cases of breach of privileges made by the members of houses, the Parliament has punitive powers to punish them. So in this way, Parliament also acts as the judicial authority for punishing those members which breaches the privileges of the other members of the Parliament. A breach of privilege is when there is an infringement of any of the privileges enjoyed by the MPs. A privilege motion is moved by the member when he feels that a minister or any other member has committed a breach of privilege of the House or one or more of its members by withholding facts of any case or by giving wrong or disorder facts. So in parliamentary system, legislative privileges are immune to judicial control. So that is the reason why Parliament is getting the upper hand as far as punishing the those who are going to breach the privileges. The power of Parliament to punish its member is also generally not subject to judicial rule. Other judicial functions of Parliament includes the power to impeach the President, Vice President, the judges of Supreme Court, High Courts, and Auditor General, etc. Coming to know other functions of Parliament, like issues of national and international importance are discussed in the Parliament. This is very important to know. The national importance and international important issues have been discussed in the Parliament. The opposition plays an important role in this regard and ensures that the country is aware of the alternative viewpoints. A Parliament is sometimes talked of a nation in miniature, because here it is the place where the representatives of the people from all parts of the country are going to represent. So in a democracy, Parliament plays a vital role of deliberating matters of importance before laws and resolutions are passed. Thus, the Parliament has the power to alter, decrease or increase the boundaries of states and union territories. The Parliament also has the function as an organ of information. The ministers are bound to provide information in the houses when demanded by the members. So in this way, Parliament play an important role in reflecting the opinion of the people where the laws of the nation have been made. So this is what regarding the powers and functions of the Parliament. Thank you very much.